Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the International Military Student Office, in partnership with the Command and General Staff College and Army University, thank you for joining us today for our first Know Your World Cultural Engagement Series for the class of 2024. First, a couple of announcements. If during the presentation your child and or your spouse gets out of control, please do take them to the atrium until they're ready to come back and enjoy the presentation. At this time, please do silence all of your electronic devices. After the presentation, please join us in the atrium to meet with the presenter at the reception to sample authentic Irish cuisine and also thank him for his work on this impactful presentation. We look forward to seeing all of you there. At this time, it is my honor and privilege to introduce to you our partner from the Irish Army's Infantry Corps, Commandant Gavin Egerton. This is Know Your World, Ireland.
Comfort Gavin Egerton is Anam Dum. Agastame on a broad duel as lower live new free mater era allin. Ladies and gentlemen, Commandant Gavin Egerton is my name, and I'm honored to speak to you today about my beautiful country, Ireland. The agenda for my presentation is as follows. After a brief introduction and a video, I will talk about Ireland, the place. I'll talk about our geography, our economy, our history. I'll then talk about Ireland, the people, and give you an indication as to what we think we're about and to what we think we have offered the world. I'll then speak about the Irish Defence Forces, focusing on our main military output, that through our substantial contribution to peacekeeping operations. But first, I will give you a little sample of Ireland, and I want this video to remain in your mind as a mental reference point for the rest of the presentation. We'll be right back. Now, before we get into the main presentation, I think we should just try and find Ireland on a map. So where in the world is Ireland? Ireland is located on the eastern side of the Atlantic Ocean, on the west of Europe. We're members of the European Union, and our nearest neighbour is the United Kingdom, with whom we share a land border. I'll now discuss Ireland, the place. Firstly, as you can see from the image, the island of Ireland is an island of two countries. There are 32 counties on the island, 26 make up the Republic, and 6 make up Northern Ireland, which is part of the United Kingdom. The border between Ireland and Northern Ireland is soft, meaning there are no fences or checkpoints, and people live and work together on opposite sides of the border, mixing across communities on a daily basis. People travel for work, fun, and education every day. The official name for my country is Éire in Irish, or Ireland in English, and it's described as the Republic of Ireland. Sometimes you might hear people refer to us as the Republic of Ireland to differentiate between us and Northern Ireland. Our capital city is Dublin on the east coast, with a population of 1.27 million. And as I mentioned, there are 26 counties that make up the Republic, and I'm from the largest county, which you can see on the bottom of the screen, Cork. Cork is also home to the second largest city in Ireland, Cork City, with a metropolitan population of 305,000. And incidentally, Cork is also the best county and best city in Ireland. Now, I think some of the people at the back in the cheap seats can't really see that text, so I think I have a better image that might explain it for you. So I'll now discuss national emblems. First of all, the coat of arms of Ireland is a gold Trinity College harp with silver strings mounted on a St. Patrick's blue background. That blue is also known as azure blue, and incidentally, that's the national colour of Ireland, not green, as you probably would expect. The Irish flag was designed in France in 1848, and it's a tricolour of green, white, and orange. The green represents the Catholic or nationalist background, the orange represents the Protestant or Unionist background, and the white represents the everlasting peace between the two. It's been our national flag since the founding of the state in 1922. Now, since arriving here, many people have asked me how much Irish is spoken in Ireland, if at all, and some people have been kind enough to compliment me on my English. Now, it might surprise you that in the recent census, 40% indicated that they could speak Irish, but only 1.4% or 72,000 people actually speak Irish on a daily basis outside of education. And typically, these are people that live in Gaeltacht areas, which are areas that they choose to speak Irish and they get a special designation. In terms of our national holiday, many of you already know that St. Patrick's Day is our national holiday. It is celebrated on the 17th of March every year. As you can see on the bottom left, it's a family fun day, it's a public holiday, and typically people will attend with their families to one of the many parades in every city and large town in the country. The picture on the bottom left of your screen is Dublin City Centre, where 500,000 people turn out to our largest parade. The image in the centre, anyone guess where that is? New York City, home to the largest St. Patrick's Day parade in the world, 2 million spectators. And a city has been kind enough to dye their rivers green every St. Patrick's Day. Does anyone recognize that city? Chicago, where 800,000 people attend St. Patrick's Day celebrations there. Ireland's economy is enjoying sustained growth. Our gross domestic product last year was $529 billion, and according to the World Bank, our GDP per capita was over $104,000, set to increase by 5.5% by the end of this year. To compare it to the US, which was just over 76,000 for the same period. And before anyone asks me for a loan, that hasn't necessarily translated to army officer salaries. Our unemployment is at a near record low of 4.3%, but where does everyone work? Well, it might surprise you to learn that despite all our arable land, our 6.6 million cows and our 4 million sheep, only 1% of our economic activity is from agriculture. 38% comes from industry, where our manufacturing outputs include pharmaceuticals, medical devices, chemicals, computer hardware and software, and food and beverages. A staggering 55% of our economy resides within the services sector. And that sector includes financial services, banking, but also aircraft leasing, where it might surprise you to learn that 50% of the world's leased aircraft are managed by Irish companies. In both manufacturing and services sectors, Ireland attracts enormous foreign direct investment. Beginning in 1953 with IBM, many US firms such as Intel, Hewlett-Packard, Facebook, Twitter, etc., have located their European headquarters in Ireland. That's an awful lot of foreign direct investment, and we do have a low tax base, which led to economist Paul Krugman referring to it as leprechaun economics, but he's obviously just jealous. One attractive factor is indeed our low corporate tax rate of 12.5%, but another factor is our workforce. Ireland has a young, highly educated English-speaking workforce. We have the youngest population in Europe, and we're boasting very high education levels, where our GDP created per working hour is twice the EU average. Our skilled graduates fuel Ireland's talent pool in science and technology, and our universities collaborate with industry to help source the skills needed in the future. In fact, Ireland has the highest level of third-level attendance in the EU, amongst 25 to 34-year-olds. The EU average is 42%, and we're at a staggering 62%. So I talked about economic outputs and some of the goods we export, but who does Ireland trade with? Well, in 2022, Ireland exported $222 billion worth in goods, a 26% increase in the previous year, and we imported $155 billion, an increase of 35%. The impact of Brexit, the UK's exit from the EU, meant that our imports from Great Britain are down 10%, but cross-border trading with Northern Ireland is up 31% overall. As you can see from the figures on the screen, our main trading partner is the EU, but both the UK and US are significant contributors to our trade as well. In terms of what we export, there are some recognisable Irish brands, and our extensive and expanding whisky range is something some of you are familiar with already. Irish whisky is known in Irish as Uisce Bathe, and it literally means the water of life, but the word Uisce, the word whisky is derived from that, and you can see the connection. What makes Irish whisky unique is that it's triple distilled, its aging process is deep rooted in history and traditional practices, and as a result, it has a very smooth finish and quite a subtle flavour palette. After decades of decline, there has been a resurgence since the 1990s in Irish whisky distilling, and as you can see from the map, we boast some 42 distilleries across the whole island of Ireland. Notable brands that you may recognise include Jameson, Greenspot, and Redbreast, and one that might hold a special place in CGSE, particularly the students on the MMAS project, Writer's Tears. Other brands include Kerrygold Butter, which I see is enormously popular in this country, and of course, probably our most famous recognisable brand, Guinness. Everyone knows our black stout with its gold harp and its creamy white head, and it's been brewed in St. James's Gate in Dublin since 1759, and the Guinness Storehouse Visitor Centre is actually the most popular tourist destination in Ireland. Now, I'd love to talk to you for 45 minutes about Irish history, but I've been confined to this segment of the presentation. Unfortunately, our history is rich with stories of conquest and invasion against us, and many, going back as far as the Viking raids from Scandinavia, have shaped who we are. But I want to focus on a couple of key events that made us the country that we are today. In 1169, the Anglo-Norman invasion of Ireland began a period of 800 years of English or British rule or involvement in Ireland in some way. It was a systematic and sequential defeat of Ireland's many disparate kingdoms. Then later, the plantations of Ireland began a mass migration of English settlers into Ireland and the displacement of Irish landowners. Between 1556 and 1641, the English Crown confiscated Irish land and colonised it with settlers from Great Britain. The Crown saw plantation as a way, in their words, to anglicise and civilise Gaelic Ireland, and if the original landowners resisted, they were killed. The largest, most successful of these plantations was in Ulster, in the northeast of the country, where large numbers of English-speaking Protestant settlers moved in, creating a very large community which has become today Northern Ireland. Following a failed rebellion in 1641 and the later passing of the penal laws across all of Great Britain and Ireland, which severely restricted the rights of Catholics, the man in the bottom centre of the screen, Oliver Cromwell, embarked on a very violent conquest of Ireland from 1649 onwards. In what was a particularly dark period in our history, Cromwell captured the cities of Dublin and Derry, as well as securing the port towns of Wexford and Drogheda. In the case of the latter two, this involved siege warfare that saw thousands of civilians killed. Cromwell was bitterly anti-Catholic following the 30 Years' War that had just ended in Europe, and he exacted a viciousness on the Irish people that saw almost all Catholic Irish land confiscated and the inhabitants moved to the west of Ireland, where the land was typically less fertile and arable. He famously offered the ultimatum to Hell or to Connacht, referring to the choice between debt or to Ireland's most westernmost province. The brown area shaded on this map is largely Connacht, and they are the counties that were reassigned to Catholics, and the areas in the various shades of blue and navy were reserved for or given to English government personnel or army officers. In 1798, an unsuccessful rebellion by 50,000 lightly armed United Irishmen, supported by 4,100 French soldiers, thanks Louis, wherever you are. After initial success in various locations around the country, the rebel force was defeated by the better equipped and better organised British forces. However, although a failure, 1798 was celebrated as there was a number of early successes. It loomed large in the Irish psyche, particularly at the centenary celebrations in 1898, which actually inspired later rebellions and uprisings in Ireland. But however, following 1798, the British enacted the Act of Union in 1801, formally joining the UK and Ireland together as one country, and merging the Protestant churches of Ireland and England. As the image on the right shows, the Union Jack flag that you will know today entered common usage, and the diagonal red stripes were added to it, which actually depict St. Patrick's flag representing Ireland. And people often speak to me about the luck of the Irish, and I've heard this phrase used many times since I got here, so you probably think our luck couldn't get any worse. Enter the famine. So on Gorta Mór, otherwise known as the Great Famine, began in 1845 when the potato crop failed. At this time, Ireland was made up of 80% peasant Catholics who worked the land that was now owned by English landowners, in many cases increasingly absentee landlords. The Irish Catholics served as tenant farmers, and the foodstuffs and livestock that they tended to were mostly exported to England for sale. The poor farmers had come to rely on the potato due to its ease with which it could be grown, particularly on the less arable land. They not only relied on it for sustenance, but they also used it as a source of income. Thus, when it failed, they not only starved, but they lost the ability to pay their rent and were evicted. Ireland had a population of 8 million in 1841. From the famine effect, 1 million died of starvation and 1 million emigrated, mostly to Britain, North America and Australia. And this was the beginning of a century-long decline in the Irish population. So you're probably wondering why I mentioned this sad event, the famine. Well, the tragedy of famine looms very large in the Irish psyche today. As you can see from this image, we have public monuments all over the country, but mostly in the west of Ireland, in Connacht, where the effects were most felt. However, one significant positive outcome of this was from the migration that resulted. The Irish diaspora around the world today is enormous. Some 34.5 million Americans can trace their ancestry to Ireland. I've lost count the number of times that members of staff, fellow students, strangers in the street have come up to me to talk about Ireland and their Irish ancestry. And please keep doing that, because it's actually very nice. You simply have to look at the store names, street names, restaurant names in any American city, including Kansas and Leavenworth, and you'll see Irish surnames. And since, just to show you how small the world is and how this connection is, since we've arrived here, we found out that Kerry Brown, who you'll meet outside, proprietor of Brown's Irish Marketplace in Kansas City, is related to my wife. That's not why she's catering today. I mentioned earlier how St. Patrick's Day is celebrated in the US, but it's also celebrated all over the world. And I can't think of any other country whose National Day is celebrated so enthusiastically all over the world. This means as a very small country in the west of Europe, our diaspora gives us an enormous outreach and a global reach across the planet. So the general socio-economic situation Ireland the Catholics found themselves in was exacerbated by the famine and inspired a number of rebellions and uprisings against British rule that failed. Although they failed, they did inspire many more to take up arms and fight for Irish freedom. And the path to independence finally took a firm hold in 1916 with the Easter Rising, when the Irish Volunteers and Irish Citizen Army, organised by the Irish Republican Brotherhood, took up arms and took key locations around Dublin and the country. On the morning of Monday, the 24th of April, 1916, 1,200 Irish volunteers formed up in Dublin city centre and marched in formation to various pieces of key terrain around the city. Some 400 marched to the General Post Office, which the image on the bottom left describes, and seized it as their headquarters. Others seized key blocking positions around the city, including the two railheads that the British were most likely to use to reinforce and respond. Soon after, Commander-in-Chief of the Irish Volunteers, Patrick Pearse, walked out of the GPO and read the Irish Proclamation aloud, declaring our independence and the establishment of a provisional government. This image shows Army officer then Captain Peter Keller, a good friend of mine, reading the proclamation on the 100th anniversary of the Easter Rising in 2016. This forms part of an annual commemoration where the reading of the proclamation is reenacted after a small military parade, and large crowds turn out to watch it every Easter to celebrate 1916. Lastly, just a week, the Easter Rising suffered from a lack of numbers, as the Irish volunteers were gradually surrounded by the British Army and defeated by a sustained artillery bombardment and an ever-tightening cordon. 485 people died during the fighting, including 66 Irish volunteers, 143 British soldiers, and 260 civilians. The Easter Rising itself was not initially a universally popular uprising. Many people blamed the destruction of Dublin city centre on the rebels themselves for attracting the violence. But the subsequent and drawn-out summary execution of its leaders by British military courts-martial resulted in generating a huge public support for the rebels, ultimately leading to the Irish War of Independence. During the War of Independence, approximately 3,000 Irish Republican Army rebels harassed and attacked the 50,000-strong British forces in Ireland. Flying columns of between 20 and 100 men used guerrilla tactics such as ambushing in the countryside, while the squad conducted targeted assassinations of British intelligence agents in Dublin. The result of this was they denied the British freedom of movement and information and restricted them to barracks and government buildings. The Director of Intelligence for the Irish Republican Army, an architect of their strategy during the War of Independence, was the veteran of 1916 and Cork man, General Michael Collins. Following a truce that ended the War of Independence, Michael Collins was one of the Irish representatives that travelled to London in 1921 to negotiate with the British. He and his negotiating party managed to secure 26 of the 32 counties of Ireland and get his dominion status as the Irish Free State. But the six of the nine Ulster counties most populated with Protestant Unionists loyal to the British Crown seceded and became Northern Ireland. The treaty also stipulated that Ireland would remain part of the Commonwealth and that we would swear an oath of allegiance to the Crown when taking up public office. This was too much for hardliners to accept, and a civil war broke out. Michael Collins famously argued that whilst the treaty terms don't give Ireland full freedom, it gives Irish people the freedom to achieve freedom. As Commander-in-Chief of the National Army, Collins and his professional soldiers defeated the smaller guerrilla anti-treaty IRA after a bloody 10-month civil war with heavy casualties on both sides, often dividing families as brother literally fought brother. But Collins did not get to see the end of the war as he was shot and killed in an ambush in his native Cork. However, Collins' words on freedom were prophetic. Whilst Ireland had gained dominion status in a situation similar to Canada in 1922, later in 1937, the country adopted a new constitution, leaving the Commonwealth and renaming itself Éire in Irish or Ireland in English. Later, following the passing of the Republic of Ireland Act, the country became a republic on the 18th of April, 1949. And it's only a coincidence that's the day I got married on. So by these two acts, the Irish people, through peaceful means and methods and political methods, achieved full freedom for 26 of the 32 counties of Ireland. The aforementioned Constitution of Ireland in 1937 established our political framework. Ireland is a constitutional republic with a parliamentary system of government. The directly elected but largely ceremonial president is the head of state and supreme commander of the Irish Defence Forces. Our current president is a hugely popular Michael D. Higgins, and he's on his second seven-year term. The Seanad or Senate is the upper house of parliament with 60 members, and the Dáil or Assembly is the lower house with 160 members representing all parts of the 26 counties of Ireland. The leader of the government is called a Taoiseach, which means chief, but is generally accepted to translate as prime minister. In terms of our geography, Ireland's climate is influenced by the Gulf Stream. Our temperature ranges from minus 5 degrees Celsius or 23 degrees Fahrenheit in winter to 26 degrees Celsius or 79 degrees Fahrenheit in summer. And incidentally, the melting point of an Irishman is about 105 degrees Fahrenheit, so I'm being very, very careful since I got here. Because of our all-year-round rain, which isn't actually every day, our lush vegetation and our temperate climate, Ireland is known as the Emerald Isle, and many people have remarked to me that passing over Ireland when they come to land, they've noticed the greenery. Our highest peak is Cairn Toul, standing at just 1,038 metres, or 3,400 feet, so we don't have hugely mountainous terrain. And the images on the screen give you an indication of what our country looks like, and you saw it from the video at the start as well. So the bottom left is the famous Cliffs of Moher, which 1.1 million tourists visited last year, primarily being from the US. And one instructor here told me that he proposed to his wife on the Cliffs of Moher, and I stupidly told my wife that, and she said, why couldn't you do something nice like that? The photo on the bottom right shows Croagh Patrick, Ireland's holiest mountain. It's the official name. St. Patrick famously spent 40 days on a holy pilgrimage there in the 7th century. The chapel that was built on the summit attracts an annual holy pilgrimage to its peak, with some people going on their bare feet. The image on the top right shows Temple Bar, Ireland's most famous tourist destination in terms of food and beverages. And many people have remarked to me that they've had a good experience at Temple Bar with Irish music and pubs. In terms of landmass, Ireland is approximately 70,000 square kilometres or 27,000 square miles, so it's pretty small. Kansas State, for comparison, is 213,000 square kilometres or 82,000 square miles. For scale, I've shown the island of Ireland compared to the state of Kansas. Forestry accounts for approximately 11% of total land usage, and agriculture, despite only being 1% of the economy, 67% of land usage. So I'll now talk about Irish people and our culture and what makes us unique. We like to think that we're a friendly people who place family and friends above all else. We have a very charitable and hospitable nature. We're ambitious and we have a good sense of justice. We love learning, we love poetry, we love music, we love writing, we love the arts. But above all, we think that we're really sociable. We will talk to strangers, we'll invite people to our homes, and we love talking to people who have come to visit Ireland. We love to be together to celebrate sport and concerts. And yes, some people do have red hair, but not as many as you might think. However, I think the following video will do far greater justice than I will explain what we are like as a people, and I hope you enjoy it.
West, southwest, 13 knots, 1026, rising slowly.
Here, we find ourselves. We speak, and the words mostly matter.
Greets to Gastron, high to Morgning, Dormady, Destiny, doom is the fast.
Close your eyes and pull like that.
We cry during the highs and the lows. We run fast, jump high, hit hard, fall hard, and we rise again, bruised, but never beaten.
It's over! It's gone between the posts!
I will arise and go to inner spring.
We take our land and grow glorious all that we sow.
One last time. These are small, but the ones out there are far away.
Here, we celebrate birth and death in equal measure.
There are over 70 million people who claim Irish descent.
And we love our people doing well, wherever they travel. An seo tá muid dócasach agus dúcasach.
We put St. Patrick's Day in the middle of Lent. There was no way we were gonna go 40 days and 40 nights on pancakes.
An seo bíon muid bíon agus ar bís. We stand for the weak, giving of ourselves, our time, and beyond.
Those who may feel that in these difficult times, freedom may be on the run would do well to remember Ireland.
We embrace everything and anyone.
I hereby solemnly declare Ireland has given me home, has given me a sense of worth and a sense of being.
Hey!
Here, we are open. Every day of the year.
I love our shared island. I love it for its imagination and its celebration of the endless possibilities for our people.
We are out on our own, yet never alone. Today, people and seekers of tomorrow, we are a tiny island with a massive heart. We love life, and we know life is for living. Ireland. Here, we live.
So now for some basic facts about Ireland, including some demographics. Population is just over 5 million. If you remember, I said it was 8 million before the famine. The last census of 2022, 84% people indicated they were Irish, and 12% is non-Irish. Of the 12% who are non-Irish, the largest is the Polish community, at 15%, making Polish the second most spoken language in Ireland, not Irish. Our average age is 38.8 years. Our life expectancy is 80 years for men and 83 years for women. And in that census, 69% indicated they were Roman Catholic and 2.5% Church of Ireland. And interestingly, 14% said no religion. I'll now talk about Irish music and nightlife. We use the term ceolag as crack, which means music and fun. We will say, what's the crack? He's good crack. She's hilarious crack. That was good crack last night. And the best crack is found in pubs, traditionally the traditional Irish pub. How to describe the Irish pub is basically it's quite central to our social lives. It is characterised by a casual and friendly atmosphere with the possibility of live music or song breaking out without notice. Many traditional Irish pubs have what's called a session where people will bring musical instruments and strangers, after a couple of drinks, will play music together with people joining in or leaving as the night progresses. Most small towns and villages in Ireland have a pub, and typically that serves as the centre of the village in terms of social and community activity. We would consider ourselves quite rich in arts and heritage and music. We take very serious pride in our music, be it traditional or modern. And we have a number of musical exports you may recognise. Does anyone recognise this band? Cranberries, very good. These four gentlemen. U2. And then the inescapable Riverdance. It's there since 1994. It's not going away. We can't get away from it. Of course, the great social lubricant also helps us sing and dance and get to know each other. In terms of Irish cuisine, there's probably a reason you don't see Irish restaurants around the place. We're not as rich in cuisine culture as France or India or Mexico or Italy. But we do have some staple meals which are popular both in Ireland and with visitors to come to Ireland. And any serious Irish pub you'll see in the US will probably serve one of these meals if they serve food. So as we're an island nation, we eat a lot of seafood and we eat salmon, which you'll get to sample outside, hake, cod. But mussels are quite popular in Ireland and considered quite a delicacy. We have famous Clonakilty black pudding, or just black pudding in general, and I won't tell you how it's made. And we have the full Irish breakfast, which is not something we eat every day, but if you had a late night the night before, it's usually something you'd seek. And that's hash browns, sausages, black and white pudding, beans, fried egg, rashers, which is what we call bacon, and fried tomato, which is what one of the characteristics of the Irish version. People in Dublin eat coddle, a slow-cooked meal, which is the combination of boiled bacon pieces, sausages, carrots, and then potatoes are added later. It doesn't look appetizing, but it is quite delicious. We have our famous soda bread, which you'll also get to sample outside, and probably one of our most famous meals, Irish stew, traditionally made with lamb, which is the version you'll get outside, but also made with beef, because we have a lot of cows as well. Of course, after a meal, it's usually all washed down with a nice cup of tea, and people tend to choose what tea they drink based on a binary choice. Normally, you go Barry's or Lyons, and since Barry's is associated with Cork, it's therefore the best, and that's the tea we have outside. Now, Ireland has given the world a number of literary giants, and I know people have mentioned these to me since I've arrived, so I know people are familiar with them. So from left to right, we have James Joyce. He famously wrote Ulysses, which many of you have told me you've read, and you're all liars because it's too hard to read. We have Bram Stoker, who wrote Dracula. We have Oscar Wilde, who famously told customs officers upon entering New York that he had nothing to declare but his genius. We have Jonathan Swift, author of Gulliver's Travels. And then finally on the right, poetry giant Seamus Heaney, Ireland's most celebrated poet and winner of the Nobel Prize for Literature. He's also the favourite poet of President Joe Biden, and he quotes him quite regularly in speeches. The sport is very important to people in Ireland to play and watch. We have many people following English Premiership soccer teams, and so that makes soccer quite popular. We also are quite good at golf. We have many famous golfing legends, including Patrick Harrington, who has won 37 titles, including three majors. Ireland are currently world number one ranking in men's rugby, and we hope to do well in the World Cup. We're off to a good start, a little bit too good, I think, from an injury point of view. And then the photo on the right shows our team winning the Grand Slam in the Six Nations tournament earlier this year. We also have our famous boxer, Olympic gold medalist turned professional, Katie Taylor. She's one of only eight boxers in history, male or female, to hold all four major titles in boxing simultaneously. However, by far the most popular sports in Ireland are the Irish games of hurling and Gaelic football. The Gaelic Athletic Association, or GAA, is a cultural and sporting organisation founded in 1884 to promote the Gaelic games and Irish pastimes. The GAA has 500,000 members globally. There are 2,200 GAA clubs in Ireland, 400 clubs worldwide, 100 of which are in the USA. The image shows the headquarters of the GAA, Croke Park in Dublin, on an All-Ireland final Sunday. It's packed to capacity with 82,000 people, all there to watch the final two counties battle it out for glory. Except the warriors that they are there watching are unpaid amateurs, not professionals. They all have day jobs, and they do this for the pure passion for the sport and for pride in their county. As you can see from the example on the left, hurling is a mixture of hockey, lacrosse, and murder. Gaelic football on the right, a little bit more civilised but equally entertaining. And in both cases, there's 15 players per team. Games are 70 minutes of 2 30- to 5-minute halves. The objective is to score by hitting or kicking the ball over the bar to score a point, or getting a pass to keeper into the net to score a goal, which is worth 3 points. And incidentally, if anyone wants to learn more about these sports or to practice them, I encourage you to reach out to anyone other than me, because I'm not very coordinated. I'll now move on to the final part of my presentation, that on the Irish peacekeepers. I'll now discuss the Defence Forces, an organisation which I am extremely proud to serve. As I mentioned from the outset, Irish people are extremely proud of our peacekeeping tradition and as a non-military aligned state. By being non-aligned, it gives us the credibility as impartial interlocutors, as well as witnesses to ceasing hostilities. Being a former colonised country ourselves, it helps us relate to communities in which we have deployed soldiers and peace support operations. Before I discuss the Irish Defence Forces and our proud peacekeeping history, I want to show you a short video that I feel gives a good overview of the Irish Defence Forces and its three components: the Army, the Naval Service, and the Air Corps. That was actually a recruitment video, so we have some application forms out in the atrium for anyone who's interested. The Irish Defence Forces originated as the Irish Volunteers, who were founded in 1913. I mentioned earlier that the Irish Volunteers fought in the Easter Rising of 1916, and their blood sacrifice for Irish freedom is honoured and remembered by retention of their uniform as the modern Irish Army, which is what I'm wearing now. In fact, the term Óglaigh na hÉireann, the Irish for Irish Volunteers, is the accepted official translation of Irish Defence Forces. Our cap badge is the exact same as that worn by the Irish Volunteers, and our buttons have the Irish harp and the letters IV for Irish Volunteers. An important event in Irish military history I think you might find interesting occurred between 1926 and 1927, known as the Irish Military Mission to the USA. The fledgling Irish state, only 4 years old, had a need to modify and professionalise its armed forces to enable it to fulfil the full functions of a modern army. These six officers on the screen set out across the Atlantic to make a general study of the United States military system, focusing on military education. This included tours and inspections, as well as participation in courses at Fort Benning's Infantry School, Fort Sill's Field Artillery School, as well as the two officers in the bottom left of the screen, Hugh McNeil and Michael Costlow, both later Lieutenant Generals, attending the Command and General Staff course at Fort Leavenworth. Upon their return to Ireland, they helped create the Irish Military College, including its Cadet School, Infantry School, and the Command and Staff School, which was modelled on this school. Personally, I am extremely humbled and honoured to be following their footsteps as the 30th Irish officer to attend this fine institution. It might surprise you to learn just how small we are. There's only 7,500 in the Army, 900 in the Air Corps, and 1,100 in the Naval Service. These figures do not include the reserve. And much like many militaries around the world, and I'm sure everyone understands when I say this, we are suffering from a recruitment and a retention crisis as the buoyant economy and private sector compete in the same labour market as we do. Our command structure sees that we have a general staff of the Chief of Staff as a Lieutenant General, two Major Generals as the Deputy's Chief of Staff, Operations and Support, and Assistant Chief of Staff, who is a graduate of this course. We also have the Joint Task Force, and you'll see at the bottom of the screen, the Army is arranged into two brigades and Defence Forces Training Centre, as well as one-star appointments commanding the Air Corps and Naval Service. This is set to change, and we'll be renaming the Air Corps the Air Force and the Naval Service the Navy, as well as creating Chief of Army appointment, Chief of Air Force, Chief of Navy, and expanding the force by 2,000 in the coming years. The Air Corps consists of a balanced fleet of 26 mixed fixed and rotary wing aircraft to carry out a variety of roles, such as maritime air patrol, light air policing and light strike capability, intelligence, surveillance and reconnaissance, and support to the Army, as you can see from the helicopters in the bottom right. The Naval Service operated a modern fleet of six ships. The roles include maritime defence and security operations, where they patrol Ireland's extensive exclusive economic zone, an area of 480,000 square kilometres, or seven times the total landmass of Ireland. And they also provide an aid to the civil power by conducting armed boarding of vessels suspected of carrying drugs or other contraband. The Irish Army is equipped with modern weapons, vehicles and military hardware, and it's organised and into two combined arms brigades. They have either three or four infantry battalions in each brigade, and an artillery regiment, a cavalry squadron, and all the other support you'd expect to help an army function across the spectrum of operations. The workhorse of the Irish Army is the MOAG Piranha APC, as you can see at the top of the screen, and all soldiers, when they deploy in peace support operations, will conduct mechanised infantry training first and operate from these vehicles when they deploy. As you can see from the bottom left photo, we are equipped with modern anti-tank weapons such as the Javelin anti-tank guided missile. We also have the Army Ranger Wing, or Special Operations Force. They are organised into task units specialising in combat diving, maritime insertion, land and air insertion, and sniping. Their wartime, or green role, sees them conduct long-range reconnaissance, raids, ambushes, and sabotage, while their anti-terrorist, or black role, includes counter-hijack, air and seaborne interventions, hostage rescue, close protection of VIPs, etc. And you will note from the image in the top right that their Fianna Fáil tab, which they get for qualification, bears a striking resemblance to the Ranger tab, which many fellow students have. This is because the original members of the Army Ranger Wing were graduates of the Ranger course in Fort Benning, and they formed the nucleus of this unit when it was created. Now, I've mentioned our long and proud history of peacekeeping, but now for some more detail. Ireland as a young republic joined the United Nations in 1955. Shortly after, in 1958, some 50 officers were assigned to the United Nations Observer Group in Lebanon. When their mission ended, some of them transferred to the United Nations Truce Supervision Organization, or UNSO, in the Middle East, which was established in 1948 and still exists today, and we still provide officers to UNSO, and many of my fellow IMS students have said they've served with Irish officers on UNSO. Since the first deployment in 1958, we provide a continuous presence on UN missions, completely unbroken, where we've had staff officers, military observers, and larger armed contingents. For Ireland, these larger contingents typically took the form of an infantry battalion of about 600 personnel, or infantry groups of up to 400 personnel. By joining organisations such as NATO PFP, the Organisation for Security and Cooperation in Europe, and opting in to the European Union's Common Security and Defence Policy, Irish soldiers have found themselves spread across the globe under a variety of flags in the service of peace. The first large armed peacekeeping mission that an Irish contingent deployed to was with the Opération des Nations Unies au Congo, or ONUC, from 1960 to 1964. Some 6,000 Irishmen deployed to ONUC, and an Irish Lieutenant General served as force commander. For the Irish Army, ONUC was a coming of age. It initially highlighted some shortcomings for the Army and prompted the purchase of more modern equipment, including the FAL assault rifle and new armoured vehicles, which you can see in the bottom right, and better paying conditions. If you look at the image on the left, you'll see the 1st Battalion to deploy to the Congo did so dressed as I am now. I don't need to tell you, Congo is hot. It also saw us involved in combat for the first time as multiple actions and battles took place. And one famous action took place at Jadoville, where Commandant Pat Quinlan, pictured at the top of the screen, commanded an infantry company of 105 Irish soldiers defending against a week-long attack by 3,000 Katanganese fighters led by Belgian and French mercenaries. Cut off from any support, the Irish company repelled sustained attacks supported by mortar fire and air attack, and despite inflicting heavy casualties on the enemy, not one Irish soldier died. The action remains an important lesson in perimeter defence and is a great source of pride for the Irish Army. It was made into a Netflix movie in 2016, and I know many of you here have seen it. Some other notable deployments, just to pick a very, very small sample, include the ones on the screen. I'll talk about one or two of those. So after the Congo, we deployed an infantry group to serve with the United Nations Force in Cyprus, or UNFACYPE, from 1964 to 1973, and almost 10,000 Irish tours of duty were completed with UNFACYPE. Later, we deployed a platoon, initially from the Army Ranger Wing, then from infantry units, with the New Zealand Battalion Group as part of operations in East Timor from 1999 to 2004. From 2003 to 2007, Ireland and Sweden provided an Irish-led combined mechanized infantry battalion as the mission's quick reaction force in the United Nations mission in Liberia, and almost 3,000 Irish soldiers served with UNMIL. And in 2008, an Irish Army Lieutenant General served as the operational commander of the 4,300-strong European Union crisis management operation to Chad. Ireland provided a mechanized infantry battalion that had a Royal Dutch Marines reconnaissance platoon embedded. A special reconnaissance platoon from the Army Ranger Wing also served as part of the initial entry force. After a year, EU4 handed over to the UN, and the Irish battalion remained there until 2010 with a Finnish contingent instead of the Netherlands element. Almost 3,400 Irish soldiers served in Chad. Our current deployments include the ones on the screen, but we have 550 soldiers deployed to UN, EU and NATO PFP missions across the world. Our main deployments include an infantry battalion in UNIFIL in South Lebanon, where we lead an Irish-Polish battalion deployed along the blue line with Israel, patrolling the most active and challenging area of operations in UNIFIL. Ireland has provided an infantry battalion to UNIFIL since 1978, with a break from 2001 to 2011, and almost 40,000 Irish tours of duty have been completed with UNIFIL, making it our most notable deployment. However, it has also been our most costly mission, and to date, 48 Irish soldiers have lost their lives in Lebanon to indirect artillery mortar fire, IEDs, engagements and firefights, and most recently during an encounter with a hostile crowd and armed gunmen in December last year. Since 2013, Ireland has provided a quick reaction force with the United Nations Disengagement Observer Force on the Golan Heights, and over 2,500 Irish soldiers have served in UNDOF. And these final two I mentioned, since 2013, Irish officers and NCOs have served with the European Union Training Mission Mali, delivering instruction to the Malian Armed Forces as the EU's efforts to capacity build and improve the Army in Mali. The bottom left photo shows the early days where Ireland and the UK formed a combined training team, marking the first time that the Irish and British Armed Forces worked together. And since 1999, Irish soldiers deployed to the NATO-led Kosovo Force. The Irish contribution was initially a heavy transport company, followed later by a mechanised infantry company as part of the Finnish battalion. And currently, we have 13 officers and NCOs deployed to the headquarters in Pristina, and nearly 3,000 Irish tours of duty have been completed with KFOR. Deploying Irish soldiers to conflict zones and peace support and crisis management operations has not been without cost. Unfortunately, some 88 Irish soldiers have made the ultimate sacrifice in the service of peace. We commemorate them locally in mission areas and as well at home nationally on an annual basis. This slide gives a mere snapshot of the current overseas deployments. You can see from yourself how wide and diverse these deployments are. I should point out that having 550 soldiers deployed means that they need to be replaced by 550 more who need to train, and they've also themselves replaced 550 who have just come home and are on leave. So therefore, the real impact of having 550 deployed is far greater. And this means it's a challenge for commanders to do the necessary conventional collective training that we need at home. Peacekeeping is predicated on a solid foundation of conventional training, and you need that in order to be good peacekeepers. As Dag Hammarskjöld, while sitting as Secretary General at the United Nations, said, peacekeeping is not a job for soldiers, but only soldiers can do the job. To summarise, Ireland is a small nation with a global reach. Thanks to our huge diaspora, our strong culture and values, every country worldwide has been positively touched by Ireland in some way. Our Irish people are friendly and rich in culture, who have exported their arts and music and their Guinness around the world. Our Defence Forces are committed to peace support operations, boasting 75 years of unbroken, dedicated service to the cause of peace, in some cases making the ultimate sacrifice. Ladies and gentlemen, it's been my distinct pleasure to talk to you about my country, my people, and my Defence Forces today. And I will be outside to answer any questions in the atrium and to hopefully sample some Irish cuisine and share a Guinness with you or a cup of Barry's tea. Thank you for your attention.
Thanks, everyone, for coming out. Thank you, Gavin, for your amazing presentation. It was a pleasure to learn more about your country's culture, its influence, and its effect not only on America, but throughout the entire globe. On behalf of the International Military Student Office and the entire Security Cooperation Enterprise, we thank you for letting us be a part of your experience through this insightful engagement. For your superb personal and professional efforts, I would like at this time to provide to you the coveted CGSE Coin of Excellence for your efforts. Please join us again to give a round of applause to our partner from Ireland, Commandant Gavin Egerton. Yep, you're good. All right, the International Military Student Office would like to recognize Brown's Irish Market, Kansas City, the Hilltop Market in Easton, Kansas, and our very own Fort Leavenworth Commissary for creating the cakes and sampling of Irish cuisine, which you'll be able to have out in the atrium. We also thank our ATSD and PAO teams here in the building, and we would like to thank our student ambassador who's up in the booth supporting Commandant Egerton, Captain Promotable Max Tresnack from Staff Group 9 Bravo. They were all instrumental in helping Gavin with this amazing Know Your World Ireland presentation. And we'd also like to thank our international sponsors that are here in the room, our CGSC faculty, and our Army U staff for your continued support to this amazing Know Your World series for the class of 2024. We look forward to seeing you all on the 25th of October for Know Your World Lebanon presentation, our second for this year's class of 2024, but it will start a little bit later because of a scheduling conflict, so we'll be getting started at about 4:30 so that SCP can complete their stuff and we can get going with that presentation. At this time, please do exit to the rear of the auditorium towards the atrium to meet with Commandant Egerton and enjoy a small taste of his country's delicious cuisine. Have a blessed day. Sean Alwalia. Play the music.